Good morning or good afternoon. This is Alex Bradley from Anything Geeky Reviewed, and I have the great pleasure of talking to Julian Gollop. I think that's how you pronounce your second name.
That's right.
Okay, good. Thank you for joining me. It's actually quite a pleasure. I've got a bunch of questions, even some from some friends. Let's maximise this, actually. Who are okay, big fine, friends of yours. Yes, you're actually quite a legend to a lot of people. I don't know whether you know that, but you are. Okay, let's jump straight in. Okay, your new game is going to be Chaos Reborn, which is the third game in the Chaos series. What kind of gave you the idea of modernising it and changing it, you know, to the modern gaming scene?
Well, there's two things. One is that over the years there have been a lot of people who've sent me emails requesting that I approve of them doing a remake of Chaos. And I used to get something like 5 or 6 such requests per year. Okay. I think about around 30, 35 of these remakes have actually made it to a public playable stage. So people keep coming back to this idea, and I thought, well, there must be something in it. There must be something there that people are getting that they're not getting elsewhere. And it's definitely something that is specific to Chaos out of all my games. I think the other thing is that I have fond memories of developing Chaos. It was the first Spectrum game that I programmed in Z80 assembly code.
Okay.
It's the game that I'm, in a way, most fond of in terms of my development career and the experience I had with it. It was a real learning experience, and it was great fun. So I think those are the main reasons.
Okay, yeah. I mean, especially from my memories of Chaos, I think I played the second one a lot more. It's definitely a unique game that I haven't seen recreated anywhere else. You've got a lot of kind of, I mean, nowadays a lot more first-person shooters, but there's not really something where you kind of duel, you know, another opponent and you have to outwit them, or at least not that many games like that.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, good. With someone of your experience, you must have seen a lot change in the game industry. Obviously, you've been in it for at least 30 years now, possibly more, actually. What is the biggest change that you've kind of experienced over your 30 or 40 years in the industry?
The biggest change? Mm. Is the one biggest change? That's a very good question. Well, the biggest change is that the size of the industry has just become huge. I mean, it was really a sort of a very new and low-key affair when the games industry started. It had a big splash, for sure, and there were lots of news reports about Imagine Games and, you know, the computer whiz kids. But really, it was a lot of bedroom coders like me who were just making stuff after they left school, or young people. But now, of course, it's a super professional industry, multi-billion-dollar industry.
Yeah.
So there's so many changes that go with that. I'm just in terms of team sizes. I mean, they're enormous. I mean, like Assassin's Creed, you'll have like 500 people working on it.
Yeah, but then the budget sizes for that are way above what you guys obviously had back in the 70s and 80s.
Yeah, thousands of times higher. Well, my budget for developing Chaos was basically zero, because I was just living at home. my parents, probably the cost of the food that my parents were giving me, that's about it.
Okay, if that's the case, then do you think that because of all the money that's been pumped into the industry, do you think games have gotten better for it, or are they lacking something because of it?
Both, I think. Certain things have gotten better. I mean, actually, overall, there's a lot more diversity in games today.
Hmm.
Ranging from, casual games and mobile games, and up to, AAA games on consoles. Strategy games are still there, but they're a much smaller niche. Even so, you've got some good examples of really deep strategy games like the Europa Universalis series.
Yeah.
So I think that the diversity is one of the good things. I mean, the worst thing is, I think the downside is that innovation becomes a little bit more tricky, especially with bigger teams and bigger publishers. So there's a lot of copying of game mechanics from one game to the other. You know, particularly in the case of third-person action games, they all sort of copy each other in terms of elements that they have in their game designs. And
yeah.
It's innovation is at a relatively slow pace, but of course that's where indie gamers come in, and there's a lot more innovation and stuff going on in there.
Yeah, I mean, certainly lately, a lot of more indie gamers have come up, and it's taken off quite well, actually. First on the PC, the PC was coming to the point where people were doubting it was a gaming machine anymore, and then all of a sudden indie popped up. And then now indie's massive on even the next generation consoles, so it looks good. We've got some great games coming from indie developers rather than big AAA companies. So
yeah, it's fantastic. I mean, it's really good. I mean, this is definitely the heyday of the indie developer, I think.
Mm.
And it's partly because the distribution channels are there, and the big publishers, Sony and Microsoft, have recognised that there is value in the indie games.
Yeah,
they're a bit slow off their mark, but we'll see what happens with the next gen consoles as far as that goes. But of course, PC is still the big area for indie games.
Definitely.
Arguably, also the App Store made a big difference because it made a distribution platform accessible to small developers.
Yes, and I suppose it reduced the cost of what we would expect games to be.
Absolutely.
Obviously, 30, 40 quid isn't for everybody, but a 99p Angry Birds, sold like hotcakes.
Yeah.
Okay, well, carry on from that, actually. You're using Kickstarter, actually, to help fund the new Chaos Reborn game. What kind of brought you to Kickstarter?
Well, I was thinking about it actually more than 2 years ago, maybe 3 years ago I thought about it, because it seemed like a way to recreate what we did in a way with Laser Squad Nemesis, which is a game I made back in 2002, which was build a game and sell it directly to the public. And we kind of sold it not completely finished, but of course we used the money we raised on sending it to add features to the game. Crowdfunding is a bit different in the sense that people are buying into an idea or a concept of something before they can even get their hands on it.
Yeah.
The idea is that we've got that relationship directly with our player audience, without any intervening publisher sort of interpreting what they want. So when you're working for a big publisher or working as in a studio as part of a big publisher, your first accountability is to people within that organisation. I mean, you don't really have any relationship with the potential end consumer of your game, and I don't like that. I prefer a more direct approach, and I think Kickstarter is a way for developers to reach directly to their audience and get them involved in the process of developing and shaping the game.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it gives obviously us a say in the game development, and it allows us also to fund the sort of games we want to play. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of my friend's question is based around how older games obviously had a lot more gameplay in them, but modern games are a lot more graphical, and it's come to a point where a game doesn't get made unless it's got a huge consumer to buy it. Assassin's Creed is a perfect example. It started off as quite a small new IP, and then now it's multi-million or probably multi-billion dollar franchise itself. But of course, those new IPs don't come along without a guaranteed kind of cash flow, which I guess is where indies come in, and Kickstarter definitely helps, obviously, give you guys that option. Good. So obviously you've been thinking about Kickstarter for a few years now. Is there any kind of particular projects that caught your eye on Kickstarter?
Well, I've backed a few. I can't remember all of them, apart from Ouya, which I did back. Kind of regret that one slightly, but it's my Ouya controller broke.
Okay. I know there were a few issues with them.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I dropped it once and one trigger stopped working, and then a few other buttons and stuff stopped working. So I wasn't too impressed with the actual quality of the physical construction of the controller there.
Yeah.
But the idea was great, though.
Yeah.
I backed a few other projects, mainly small indie projects with some interesting approach to their gameplay or even visual design. And it's there's a lot of stuff there. I mean, but I think you have to. I think what's more attractive on Kickstarter is the smaller projects from indie developers who've got something a bit more unique and personal to produce. Because there are a lot of people trying to make games which are basically a copy of this, that, and the other, and there's still a lot of derivative stuff there on Kickstarter.
Yeah, unfortunately. But luckily, with something like Kickstarter, it's up to the public to back it. So,
yeah.
You know, if it's too much of a clone or something, it's not going to get funded and it's going to drop. Hopefully, anyway. Okay, so obviously, you've been in the industry for quite a while, and you've obviously made a lot of games, and some great games. There are a lot of people that respect your games. Probably a lot of people's top 10 kind of list probably has a couple of your games in them. Knowing that, how does that kind of affect the way you approach game development? Because obviously there's quite a high bar for you to make sure you hit and please, obviously, the consumers and the gamers that have followed you.
Well, I've always tended to pick game designs and game development of games which I would be interested in playing myself, and that was my original approach. I would kind of like to go back to it in a way. obviously, I tend to make a certain kind of game, and it has an audience, which is great, so which I really appreciate. And I like to keep making games in the same way. I don't. Obviously, there may be some expectations, particularly with Chaos Reborn, for example, because it's a remake of a very early game. So, for example, with Chaos Reborn, the actual, you know, the core game system, the core game mechanics are pretty much identical to what was in the original game.
Okay.
But I'm thinking of other ways to expand it and modify it to make the experience more rich and deep for players.
So it's actually going to be a remake rather than a sequel?
I would say it's part remake, part sequel. So it's remake, as I said, in the sense that the core game mechanics of the arena battles are essentially the same.
Yeah.
But there's a lot more going on. For example, there's a whole sort of RPG element to the game, and there's a whole single-player mode where you're exploring these realms and you're fighting enemy wizard lords and trying to defeat a wizard king, and there are various items of equipment and artifacts and treasures that you can get. Build your spells.
A lot more kind of RPG elements added into that.
There's a very strong RPG element added into it, yes. And a lot of it is based on procedurally generated game content, which is another thing I'm very keen on. So, for example, the arenas in the arena battle will be randomly generated, as will be the enemies you fight, and the realms that you explore will be randomly generated, and also the equipment will be randomly generated by lots of clever algorithms. So that's one thing that will give the game a lot of depth and an opportunity for players to explore a lot.
Okay. Sounds like you're going to have a lot of balancing work to work through to kind of make sure that nobody suffers too much as they progress through the game.
Yes. It's not going to be, I wouldn't say it's going to be easy, for sure.
I don't know whether you played something called FTL, Faster Than Light.
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, great game, but I often find that sometimes you start off and you just don't stand a chance. You start again and you get some much better chances to go through.
Yes, but it is quite brutal, basically, yes. You just start again. I mean, Chaos Reborn is not going to be that brutal in the sense that you can lose battles, and you can even if you get defeated, even if you find one of the realm that you're exploring is a bit too difficult, then it's not a great shame to ignore it. You still get any benefits you get from, you know, if you found any equipment, you still keep it, and you still get the experience points. So it's not a complete loss. I mean, you can always explore a new realm. To some extent, you also get to pick the difficulty because realms have a sort of difficulty level.
Mm-hmm.
And based on your current wizard level, you can pick something which is a bit higher than your level, or you can pick something a bit lower, and it's up to you. And we'll see the more difficult realm you select, the higher the rewards. Mm-hmm. But it's up to you. Okay. And you can also, other things to mitigate difficulty, you can invite, there's a very strong co-op mode in the game, so you can invite friends to join you in a particular battle against an enemy.
Okay, that sounds good. Beat him. So is it going to be kind of co-op just for that battle, or can you actually play the entire kind of solo campaign with other players?
It's just for that battle, so you have to invite players for a specific battle, and they can invite you to their battles, but otherwise the exploration part is down to you. And there is a also team-based modes for the multiplayer, so there's 2v2, for example, is one of the game modes in multiplayer. Okay. But the co-op certainly, I think, is a big thing. I mean, if you were both exploring the realm together, well, it's possible, but I want to make it a bit easier.
Yeah, obviously. And obviously it would be a lot more work to incorporate that in. The other thing is, actually, I haven't, a lot of us haven't heard a lot about you for quite a while, especially since kind of the late 90s. What have you been up to since kind of like the end of XCOM and 2002 with your Laser Squad Nemesis?
Laser Squad Nemesis, we kept going for a few years, but then when I moved to Bulgaria, I probably spent about a year renovating my flat. but I got a job with Ubisoft Sofia, so I started work there as a game designer in the end of November 2006. I worked on a game called Chess Master for Nintendo DS and Sony PSP. I became a producer. I worked on a whole bunch of projects which were cancelled. I then pitched a project to the editorial board, which I described as Ghost Recon meets XCOM for Nintendo DS. And that game actually became Ghost Recon Shadow Wars, which was a launch title for the Nintendo 3DS, and that was released in 2011.
Okay.
So that was probably my biggest achievement when I was working for Ubisoft. And it's a great turn-based game, if you ever get a chance to play it.
Yeah, I think I remember seeing it come out. It was definitely a turn-based strategy game, a lot like... there's another series that's quite famous on the DS.
It's a bit similar to Advance Wars, in the way it's controlled, but actually, you know, the gameplay is quite unique. So I guess you probably could describe it as maybe a cross between Laser Squad and Advance Wars.
Yeah.
Really?
I thought when you said a mix between Ghost Recon and XCOM, I thought you meant a first-person shooter. I didn't actually think of strategy.
Basically, we're just taking the setting of Ghost Recon, but otherwise the gameplay is pure turn-based gameplay.
Okay.
And then I worked on Assassin's Creed 3 Liberation for PS Vita for about a year before I left Ubisoft on paternity leave, and then I considered my future and decided to go indie again.
Okay. With the new Chaos Reborn project, do you actually have any support from any old colleagues or friends who helped you build some of the older games?
Not as yet. The team I've got is based locally here in Sofia, with one or two in other countries. So it's mostly guys. Some of them people I've worked with before, but mostly they're quite new to the Gollop experience, I guess.
Okay, fair enough. I think you've probably already answered this, but is there anything new in the Chaos Reborn that wasn't in the previous games?
I partially answered it anyway. And the main thing is certainly the single player realm exploration mode. It's big, big part of the game. And in terms of the arena battles, I guess the main thing is that you've now got terrain. It's multi-level terrain with different environment types, forests and mountains and citadels and stuff, which has an impact on the game. And we've got more spells which have these terrain effects, like volcanoes and earthquakes.
Okay, so I presume a volcano can only be used on top of a mountain, things like that, or...?
No, you cast volcano pretty much on any empty land space, and it causes the terrain to erupt up into a mountainous shape.
Yeah.
Very small mountain. But basically, it causes the... and then there's a whole lava spewed out of the top of it, basically, for a fairly random damage effect over a wide area.
Fair enough.
So we have some terrain effects there. The other thing possibly is the equipment that you equip your wizards with is a new factor. So basically in the RPG system, you don't change the basic stats of your wizard as such, but you can level up your items of equipment individually.
Okay.
By entering their inner realm, which is where you have to fight a sequence of sort of dungeon-style battles against some rather unusual guardian-type opponents in order to level up your equipment.
That actually sounds like quite a good idea.
Yeah, and each type of equipment has special abilities and special modifiers to your basic stats, which adds a new dimension to the game. So you can now configure both your equipment and your spells before you go into a battle.
Okay.
So this combination of equipment and spells gives you a whole bunch of different playing styles for you to choose from.
Okay, cool. Sounds pretty good. Any details on the story, or is it going to be pretty much battles between two wizards?
The story is very simple. Basically the world is thrust into chaos. I mean, the world is controlled by gods. Mm-hmm. Some of them are chaotic, some of them are lawful, some of them are neutral. But the conflict between them is what's caused these realms to appear. So essentially you're trying to win the favor of one of the gods. You have to prove yourself in various types of ways. One of which, of course, is by accumulating your own personal power, but also your personal wealth and collecting certain sets of equipment. You can create or join guilds, which also pledge their allegiance to demigods and gods within the game. Attain guild rankings and multiplayer rankings. So there's a whole set of ratings for your player. And depending on what particular god prefers what types of ratings, you may find yourself to be become a devoted follower of one of the gods. This is your objective. So it's not, the story is not the most complicated thing in the world.
Yeah.
What there is, of course, is a lot of stuff to explore. So in terms of cooperating with other players, I guess the guild system is going to be interesting because you can share your knowledge with your about certain realms with your other members of your guild, and you can share it and trade equipment with them, and maps for realms you can also share. So there's a whole cooperative element there in the guild system.
Okay, so if each realm is kind of randomly generated, how would sharing information on it be useful for other players?
Well, basically, when you enter a realm, I mean, you're basically going in there solo, basically, and exploring it.
Mm-hmm.
But if you know the name of the realm, you can give it to another player, and he can explore that realm. He can enter it and explore, and if he goes into it, he'll explore the same realm.
Okay, so there could be even more missions that you could share between friends past just the whatever missions you've been given.
Yeah, actually, yeah, because there's basically a public roster of available missions, and this will change from day to day.
Okay.
So there'll be something new to explore probably every day, but there'll be some, there'll be some realms that you haven't managed to find, which other players have explored, and they recommend to you, because it's got this piece of equipment which you can find in this particular location which might be useful to you. So that's what I mean about sharing the knowledge.
Okay, so once the kind of world's been randomly created, all the items and the monsters in that realm are there for a certain amount of time, and then someone else can come in and get the same kind of rewards from that mission.
Yes, they can. Yeah. But they say the realms don't exist forever, so they'll be closed eventually.
That sounds pretty cool. Okay, I think that's pretty much all my questions. Actually, the last one from me is going to be, when's it coming on Kickstarter?
It will be on Kickstarter in the middle of February.
Okay, cool.
About February 16th.
Sounds good. Just the only questions I've got left are from a couple of friends. One, he's a big fan of yours, one of my friends, and basically asks, do you think gameplay has lost out to graphics somewhere in the history of gaming, and when do you think that happened?
Well, yes, it probably did. when did it happen?
Yeah.
Probably happened when we made the transition from board games to computer games.
Yes, I suppose when computer games first came about, obviously they had to be simplified to be programmed. Yeah.
But even at the beginning, there was still a bit of an obsession with graphics over gameplay in one part of the market.
Mm.
I guess, but it still has to come back to gameplay eventually. Otherwise, players will get just bored from.
I mean,
a film or something.
a pretty picture in a game lasts 5 seconds. You know, the gameplay, if it hooks you, then it can last. I mean, to this day, I can still play Enemy Unknown, the original. That's 20 years old. You know, I can still happily sit down, game, and enjoy it just as much as I did the first time I played it. So, obviously, yeah, there's definitely a big difference between the two.
Yeah.
Second good question is, obviously, as you mentioned, a lot of games used to be board games. So a lot of the early gamers were often board game players or miniature tabletop miniature players.
Yeah.
And they obviously liked a lot of the games, Rebel Star series, sorry, Laser Squad and XCOM. Now, do you think that there's kind of still a market for these sort of games, or do you think that there's the market for the latest types of games, you know, FPSs, COD, Battlefield, do you think that's kind of taken over the market, or do you think there's still a market for the older type of games?
Yeah, there is. There's still a market for turn-based strategy games or tactical games. I'm pretty convinced there is. I mean, the new XCOM has done pretty well, of course.
Yes.
And there are some excellent games on the iPad, for example, which are turn-based strategy games. So I think I was playing Battle of the Bulge the other day.
Mm.
And there are some interesting sort of roguelike games also on iPad. I was playing Hoplite just yesterday, for example, which is a very interesting game. So I think there are, there's a lot of scope still for turn-based games. I'm optimistic, put it that way.
Fair enough. He also asked, because of tablets coming to the kind of peak of their era and, you know, a lot of games being made for them, have you ever thought about making any games for a tablet or maybe a mobile phone?
Yes, certainly, yeah. I mean, it's something for the future because our Chaos Reborn is for PC, Mac and Linux to start with.
Yeah.
But we'll see. We'll see where it goes.
Okay, fair enough. I think I'm all out of questions. Do you have anything you'd like to say or ask?
No. Well, you know, just check out the Chaos Reborn website if you get a chance.
Yeah, definitely. As soon as this video goes up and your Kickstarter goes up, I'll be putting a link in the bottom for anybody who wants to link straight to it.
We've got a forum there as well, so you can ask any questions you like.
Actually, you want to discuss any of the rewards for the Kickstarter? Or are they going to be kept top secret?
I can't reveal anything just yet, but I will be putting something about the rewards on the Chaos Reborn forums probably next week.
Okay. Any chance of a playable version when you back it?
It will be available to players soon after the Kickstarter is over. I can't say how soon, though. We've currently got a playable prototype, which is currently web-based. And we've got about 33 spells implemented on that, and it's multiplayer only.
Okay.
So there'll be some variation of this prototype will be made available, but it needs to be spruced up a bit.
Yeah, fair enough. Well, it's been a great pleasure for me to interview you today. Thank you very much for joining me. I hope you've enjoyed the questions and had a bit of fun.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, and good day, sir.
Good day.